So the draft's actually about to begin. If we got it up on your side as well, we'll jump straight into things. The map of choosing is Dragonshire, and Negative Synergy do have the first pick, first ban. So, well, I suppose there's a lot of different strategies you can go into this map with. Usually Zagara is a high priority pick. Whether or not they choose to take that away or utilize it as a first pick, it's going to be up to them.
Yeah, we do usually see a lot of control in either the top or the bottom lane. Just trying to hold the one point. Sometimes you even see like a heavy kind of mid composition sitting around the mid, and as soon as those two caps points are capped, the mid just goes so alive with danger. And the first ban actually being Tyrande is such a strong pick.
Even after the changes as well, even after those changes, Tyrande is still really strong straight away. Vice respond with Thrall once again, a lovely new hero. After those scaling changes came around, his early game and mid game got a really huge buff. So. Strong denial picks at this stage, and there we go. The Zagara does get first pick, usually a staple in the top lane, has so much early game pressure, really hard to try and respond with. And no surprise that Ufa instantly taken away, and Kael'thas locked in as well. Very fast draft, they're very certain of what they want, and this is great to see.
Yeah, I mean, you can't really go wrong with the Ufa first pick. Ufa always been so strong, like the Defiant Shield, you've got so much healing. Increased healing, amplified healing, the talent being. And, you know, just so annoying. You try and take them down, the Benediction comes out with the double Holy Light, topping them off almost straight away. So you can waste a lot of damage, a lot of time actually trying to take out these targets just for Uther to top them right back up, or Divine Shield negating all the damage, you know, so very strong.
Yeah, absolutely right. And I say we do see Janna now being responded. The second wizard on the table has been taken away. Joanna also as well gives him some lovely little wave clear in that mid lane. And Happy Rage, what are we expecting to come out of Vice here from a second ban?
Oh, sorry. I was talking to somebody. Second ban. Oh, I haven't really been watching at this stage, but I would say probably a tank of some sort just to remove the front line. What haven't they picked up? Actually, I got no idea. Karazin.
Karazim actually does get taken away. Karazim very strong as well, especially when people decide to go for the seven-sided strike. But most likely, they're probably using it as a denial pick for the palm. Benjamin94, very well-renowned for his monk play. So they may have done a bit of strategy and sort of research pre to the game to figure out people's niche picks.
Yeah. It's always good to get those bans out and target players if you know them quite well. Can really throw off their game, especially if they... like you said, it is their niche or their forte, you know, and it can really, in such a big game like this, in such a critical game, rather, it can really put you on a bit of a tilt, but hopefully, and I wouldn't be surprised, I think you'll be alright, and you know, these, like we were saying before, these are veteran players, no strangers to the danger, so to speak, so I'm sure they're all feeling the nerves, but certainly I am, and I think I can speak for you, Skimmy. The nerves are settling in for me too this day. It's going to be very, very exciting.
Oh, I'm excited. We're going to be in for the long run, and they say ETC now being taken away. The Kael getting a lot of love these days, especially with his mosh pit plays. Can really, really do work. And,
I mean, the combo with Uther as well. We saw it in the other games the other day while we are doing some stuff.
We actually saw the Divine Shield on the mosh pit. You can't interrupt it. And also another point whilst we're actually talking about Uther, you can Divine Shield the person actually trying to capture the dragon. You're completely immune. Yeah. There's nothing you can do. And we've seen it time and time again in the European scene, I believe. And Sylvanas is the second pick, giving him a bit more wave clear once again. But I would be saying that's a Sonya, most likely going up and against that Zagara in the top lane there.
Yeah, a very strong pick against Zagara. Quite squishy. And you've got a lot of healing. Obviously, a lot of creep's going to be out on the map. So you can get the Whirlwind. You know, it really does... help you regenerate your life force a whole lot faster. Sylvanas, such a strong counter pusher. I would imagine she'd be in the bot lane.
I would say so.
Counter pushing, kind of counter reacting to the Zagara. And she can be very annoying as well. Obviously, no stranger to her. So much pushing power, and disabling the turrets can really turn the tide of a game, especially when you're trying to control the bottom lane or top lane, respectively.
It gives them a lot of options in terms of pushing, and they are going to respond with Vala now. That's their auto attacker. And Malfurion is the final pick. So that's their.
It's been a while since I've seen a Malfurion.
Yeah, it is. Malfurion being the one of their choosing. And now Vice have plenty of time left on the clock. 50 seconds to decide this last one here. What would it be... Well, I'll say they could go for a tank. That's what they're missing from this so far. I mean, they could also go for Tassadar. But they do lock in Diablo. Diablo is a staple in the meta right now. So strong. Yeah. whether or not he goes for Lightning Breath, that's the big thing. I'm not too sure how they're going to sort of try and combo this one into an Apoc, maybe.
Oh, swapped it into Mirrodin.
Well, they actually have swapped to Mirrodin. Okay, so they haven't locked this pick in.
Let's be honest. I mean, that's... it makes me debuffs would be fantastic.
What are you thinking of this one here, Disco?
Yeah, and to be honest, when the dialogue came out, I was a bit surprised thinking Mirrodin's such a good frontline tank. You know, he's not. It's not that he has any strong characteristics. He doesn't have anything bad. You can't say anything is bad about Mirrodin. And so he's definitely a very big, strong front contender, frontliner. So I'm not surprised that they actually picked up Mirrodin as opposed to Diablo.
And what do we reckon? Do we reckon they're going to still pick up Avatar? I mean, they do have the option to kick back into the team. They obviously have a lot of follow-up with a stun and a knock-up and a Sonya. They can do lots of sort of direct damage onto one target. But after those Avatar changes, it's really going to be a case of, is it still the best one to go? Yeah. I personally haven't actually haven't tried it yet on the new patch. But we will see what happens.
Hey, Macro appears the call in chat. Maybe we will see. Maybe that's why they picked it.
Maybe some insect plays. Maybe we actually have Koreans in A and Z.
Yeah.
Just making the plays.
Yeah, making the plays with the Haymaker. Big Haymaker. So we mustn't be too far off the game, but oh my, I'm so excited to get into the first game. Negative Synergy versus Vice. The teams have selected the heroes, the hero composition of choice. We're going to be playing, of course, in Dragonshire. One of my favourite maps, actually.
What comp do you personally prefer? What team do you think actually won the draft? I mean, Ufa, very strong. I'm personally actually veering towards Vice a little bit more.
I would tend to agree. I really like the Ufa pick, you know, just in general. I mean, Zagara's so strong throughout the whole game, but if you can avoid those moors, really avoid the danger of her. Also, Negative Synergy, they've got a lot of combos that they really need to pull off. A nice big synergy, like a big wombo or something like that. They need to pick out a couple of people, get them down. If Vice plays it well, negate the damage with the Divine Shields, we could really see them come out on top of a team fight just like that. Getting rid of a Malfurion. A lot of squishy targets. Look at their team composition, you know?
That's it.
Vice has a lot of stuns, a lot of, you know, they can jump around, they can get out of fights, you know? I feel like it's a bit of a more safe comp on their side, but not to say that Negative Synergy won't take
it. You can pick a good comp. It's the execution that really matters. Dragonshire, a map requiring a lot of communication for those rotates and for the shrine caps. So we'll see if these guys have their money on the game. And
just give it a quick refresh.
We'll see where this lobby is. We'll check the chat. Please do chuck in your comments. We will be reading them throughout the day. As the lobby does now just be created.
All right, so this is going to be round one, Negative Synergy and Vice. Your casters will be Skimmy and Starving.
Bang, bang.
These guys are ready for this as we go on with the countdown.
Super. I hope you guys are too. We're going to jump into this one in just a second.
All right, we'll see you guys on the other side.
Let us know in Twitch chat who you think is going to be the winner. Give us your predictions.
Place your wages.
Place your wages. We're going to be betting virtual currency.
Maybe play a drinking game with your friends. It's, of course, a Saturday morning if you're in a...
Every time I say big plays, take a shot.
Yep, exactly. Anytime you see someone die or someone auto-attack, have a skull of your drink. Nah, we got to condone safe practices here. We are going into this game, though. And oh my, do you want to kick us off on the left side?
I shall kick us off as we do jump into the game. Let's have a look at these two team comps here. We have on the side of Negative Synergy, Robidobe is playing Joanna. Ninja is on Zagara. Sashin is playing Vala. Despots on Malfurion. And to round things off, Benjamin94 is on Jaina.
And no surprises here on the opposing team. Mirrodin being played by JediDude1. Sylvanas, JediDudeWarrior. Uther being played by Yablet. Altalai is playing Kael'thas, and Shishi playing Sonya.
Shishi, maybe a reference to Shushu Leke Meter.
Yeah, Meter, yeah.
Good old Derek, man. We do miss him. Bless your soul, wherever you are in the world, my son. But here we go. The game is underway, and Negative Synergy are stacking as a five-man unit straight towards the mid. This is a common strategy that usually occurs where they go for an early tower to get that XP advantage. Sonya and Sylvanas have already split off, so they're not going to be here to respond. But they do have free stuns available at this tower.
Ninja just lovely, lovely creep speed already. Just wants to get out, drop that stuff down and start the pushing. Does look like they're going to just group up in the mid and get a nice clear. Trying to get some sort of pressure on the mid lane. And then they can freely move to the bottom of the mid lanes. I mean, top lanes, respectively.
So there we go. It's going to be a stalemate in the top between Ninja and Sonya. I should say Zagara and Sonya. Whilst the two teams do bounce between mid and bot, respectively. And this is mainly to clear up the waves and also to pick up the Conjurer's Pursuit. So you're picking up those globes, getting those stacks, give you a lot of mana regeneration to spam those abilities.
Interestingly enough as well, we see Malfurion not going for that and actually pick up the Moonfire talent so we can get a bit more wave clear. Very smart and very, very effective as well, and scaling for that is fantastic. It does look like they're moving towards the bot. Sylvanas might be in a bad situation. No, she does get out of there nice and easy, just as we love her indeed. The Shrine's now activating for the first time this game.
Have activated, and say we switch our attention to the top lane now. Ninja already doing a lot of damage on towards Sonya. He has forced a rotate from two other members who are coming now to collectively cap this Shrine. Tap on the well has already been popped by Sonya. So Ninja does have the vision. He's had to play a little bit more passive as Kel'Thas is looking for a play. We switch our attention down to the bot lane where a four-man unit is pushing in Sylvanas. Not much she can do to respond to this.
Yeah.
They're working towards this bottom tower. And that's going to be a lot
of XP. Looks
like
this might actually go down. They're probably going to get a lot of damage off this. These towers are, of course, going to fall. And that is a lot of XP for Ninja and his team there. That's going to be really helpful for them. And it's going to relieve a lot of pressure at the bot lane. Sylvanas, of course, like we're talking about before, such a strong pusher. No real action happening, of course, with the Dragon Shrines yet. Both teams just holding their respective point on each side of the map.
So Jaina did go mid to clear out the wave where Ufa was standing still and patient. They have now come back down to go towards that fault. Ninja actually didn't actually get pushed into the towers. The towers are still extremely healthy up there in the top lane. He is now 1v1ing Sonya. Sonya's well winding away to try and keep herself sustained. But the Hydralisk as well as the auto-attacking shots coming out from Zagara are doing a lot of work. But hey, look at the trade. They are both equal, about third life total on either one. As we now check out in the mid lane, and they're having a bit of a scuffle here as they're deciding whether or not to go for the easies, which they do begin now.
Yeah, it looks like there's going to be an easy camp, so to speak. It was quite interesting as well when we're seeing that Zagara engagement up there. He chucked at the Hydralisk, and then Sonya actually speared onto the Hydralisk. So I think there might have been an intentional play by Ninja there, so very smart. But actually trying to battle out this weak point down here, Jedi Dude just say, none of that. Jumps right out of there, over that wall. Get Gotham, he says, as his teammates see the tears running down his cheek in fright there. And a one level advantage at the 3 minute mark.
One level advantage. Here we do see a little bit of an engagement. They're actually investing towards the opposing team's easy camp. Stun does miss there from Mirrodin. They're still not giving up. They do catch Ufa in a bad spot. He's getting caught here now. So much damage coming out. The shield has popped as well. Both heals have been used. Is there enough damage? It's going to be one more shot. Ufa does die in the middle lane, unfortunately for him. Zagara actually does get the cap in the top lane whilst we say this as well. Sonya now desperately looking to force on top of the fight. But Vala is going for the cap. And Sashin does get the dragon 4 minutes into this game. First dragon in favor of Negative Synergy.
Oh, that was amazing. That was a very, very nice pick by the blue team. Ninja's team, respectively, getting that pick onto Uther. He was a bit out of position there, granted, but he did try and get out of there. You saw him healing desperately, and Sashin's just going to be laying in the damage here at this mid lane, doing as much as he can. Not the strongest of the Dragon Knights, granted, but of course, you can get a lot of worth out of that. Still 30 seconds on the clock. Might see him just keep pressuring that, and look at this amazing split push. So they're getting a lot of worth out of this. They, of course, have to stay by this Dragon Knight, and they can't leave him there, because look what he's doing. He's just going to walk up and keep destroying the towers, etc.
So three members of Negative Synergy are pushing towards bot. They're uncontested whilst the Dragon commands so much pressure. Only 10 seconds left on him, but he's done work. He's already controlled, or say, taken out two towers. And they have now responded. They've sent three members up to the top lane. Once again, it's the same three people. They have forced Ninja to back. I don't believe he has well available, but the tower is still extremely healthy as his wave does get denied and pushed in for free.
Indeed, and I mean, look at the pressure that blue team is applying. They're doing a very, very good job here at just really controlling the momentum of this game. It looks like the other team opposing, they're trying to get themselves their own hard camps. So Yablet and the boys, you know, they're really looking to get some map pressure back down. You know, the Zagara's pushing them. They've got no towers at the bot lane now. It's getting very difficult for them. So they need to get their level advantage squeezed together a bit more, you know, so they aren't so far apart, and then they can decide what they can do from there. And look, Ninja team responding with their own hard camp there.
So both night camps have been captured in the top lane. Looks like they are going to push in with this one. A fight is breaking out. Oh my god, Mirrodin taking so much damage. He does jump out in the nick of time, and that trait is going to kick in any second now. As he does top himself back up, Kel'Thas also rather low, and five members of this team are now pushing in. They do clear out the enemy's knights and they're going to push on towards these two tails, which actually have no ammo, so they can't do too much to save this one. Sylvanas is sticking in the bot lane. She's looking to try and soak as much as possible. Same with Uther. And level 10 is not too far away now for negative synergy.
Shishi going very low there. They're desperately trying to hold on, but level 10 has been picked up. They need to be very careful here. They can get picked off so, so easily. So they need to be careful, and I'm sure they know this. Joanna not actually picking up her ultimate. There it goes. She picked up the shield there. Would have been very nice if she chucked that out, trying to get them those kills under the tower. But they did actually opt to go for the fort instead. Very smart. Sylvanas actually, you know, pulling the XP lead a bit lesser, and that's very, very good. You know, just as we're saying, very strong pusher. And look at the damage she could have, she did, rather, during that time.
Oh, and here they come. Vice did give up in that top lane, but they're not letting him walk out for free. The root does completely deny Kel'Thas from getting out there. There goes the Genicon, but instantly Kel'Thas dropped. Muradin caught in a bad spot. Strafe to go off. It's still doing so much work. Muradin, he's going to be the second casualty in this fight. Uther now, the third casualty. Pops his shield. The heals are also being used. Sylvanas actually did the dog run. She ran down to those bottom knights. It did manage to recall to safety. But the two shrines have been captured as Zagara picks up their second dragon off the game.
Fantastic. And this Dragonite is going to be a lot more scarier, Skimmy, my friend. He is going to be able to walk in, and the damage is going to continue to scale. It's going to continue to get more and more frightful. So Shishi and his team, they're walking up. They need to respond to this. Ninja, you know, he's not scared. He's walking up, doing as much damage as he can. Joanna getting CC'd a wee bit. There
needs to get a lot of damage onto Joanna. She's actually taking so much. Does pop the shield as well, but she is still rather healthy. The rest of her team have come back in now, and they're looking to force a fight. Ultimates are available. Joanna's shield is not available for another 10 seconds, and the only option for Vice is that divine shield. They are pushing desperately towards this gate, and we actually do see Avatar being picked up and popped there by the Mirrodin.
Yeah, it does look like all the ultimates are starting to come, or they are all up except for Jaina there for the ultimate, so they can apply a lot of pressure. Like you said, only Divine Shield really being the available ultimate. A lot of damage coming out, and they're just trying to zone out, but I mean, the damage has been done. Ninja did a fantastic job there with his team. Oh, a nice sweet dodge, that spear there. They're going to spout the end for him if he wasn't too careful.
Well, they may now respond to the bottom lane. They picked up those knights beforehand. They are banging on the door of that keep. And we do see Sashin and Ben both hanging in the wings, waiting for somebody to try and get the flank on so they can completely burst him. Rob playing extremely aggressive, and there is the Sonya. She's doing the drive-by, she's doing the wee horseshoe lap, and they might try and actually block her in. They go straight into Robodoba. That's not the target you want to go for. Strafe getting so much value out. Look at this damage that's coming across. They're all dropped to half HP. The Divine Shield goes into Sonya. That's already one casualty on towards Mirrodin. There's the second one. Uther drying is now dying, I should say. Kel'Thas as well, they completely wipe the floor with Vice. Only Sylvanas remains, and that's an open keep waiting to be taken.
Yeah, that was a really good fight for the blue team there, Ninja and the boys. That, you see how they waited there. If they waited that little bit longer, the fight already did go in their favor anyway, but I feel like if Sonya got picked right off the bat there, would have spelt the end for them anyway. So very, very smart play.
Did you actually catch who got caught in them all? I believe it was Sylvanas in the back there. I didn't actually quite see, but
yeah. I mean, the fight looked pretty rough anyway. They were taking a lot of damage, just a lot of movement going around for the red team. They couldn't quite do much, and I feel like, you know, they either had to full commit or just get out. I just don't think they could make that decision. Divine Shield being popped very late, of course, when there wasn't really much chance to get away. But I'm sure, you know, this is only the first game. This is very early as well in the first game. Only 9 minutes in.
And bear in mind, Starving, this is a best of three, so yes. It's not a one-game write-off. I say these guys might have some interesting strategies up their sleeve to try and rattle the opposing team. And, a two-level advantage, soon to be three in favor of Negative Synergy. If we have a quick look at the talents, pretty standard stuff across the board. We do have Vala taking the multi-shot build. We do have the Phoenix coming out. No Pyroblast plays today. Mm. We have seen some interesting strats in the past that have warranted that. But if we bring up the damage, leading the damage meters at this stage, 28k being pumped out of Rob's Valor there, definitely doubling anybody on the other side. And here we go, Vice doing a strong push towards this bot lane, whilst Negative Synergy have capped those knights into top, and they're coming down now to force an engagement.
And it looks like an engagement might actually break out. They need to be careful here. Ninja's in a very, very trickster spot. And Robodoba taking the front line. Very, very nice. Benjamin coming in as well. CC coming out. Ice Elemental being popped. And here comes the Blizzard. A lot of damage coming out. And Sylvanas is already so low. Divine Shield not quite being popped, but it has on the wrong target. One pick already out. Jedi dude getting taken out. And that is pretty much a team wipe right away. Very unfortunate. Just wasn't quite ready for that fight. That XP advantage just allowed them to melt through the health bars there. And look, now they can pick up another Dragonite. It's very safe to say that this isn't looking too good for the red team so far.
Not at this stage, but hey, Sonya actually did get the killer on the board. She did actually manage to pick off Jaina, so they've got their first kill onto the scoreboard there. Knights now pushing through top lane. They are responding by as a three-man unit going towards this fort, or towards the core, I should even say. Trank has now been popped by Daspy there. They are pushing in with the Dragon. Dragon being controlled by Vala, and he's going straight on towards that core. Only 11 minutes in, so it's not going to do too much. Look how much damage it's already taken. Already lost 25% of its life total, and there goes the damage. The more, honestly, it goes out, but it doesn't connect with any targets. Very unfortunate. Core down to 75% now. Oh. Can they commit? They're getting dropped so low. Ninja's already on towards the core. He's going to drop. The Living Bomb is going. Recall pops as well. Don't know what that was about, but anyway, they're chasing on. Strafe doing so much work. Ufa doing his best to try and keep him up. He dodges the grapple there from Sonya. Look at the core. 36%. The Dragon's just about to expire now.
Are they going to be able to do this?
4%. 3%.
Oh, my Lord.
And the game does end. GG, well played. Mega Synergy biting the bullet. Awesome shot calling there to really know what could be done. And game one on Dragon Chai goes in favor of the boys in blue. Mega Synergy 1-0 in the series.
Yeah, I mean, nice. You know, they really put up a good fight, but Negative Synergy, what an amazing game by them. They just really showed how confident they felt. The pressure that wasn't... You know, we talked about before the game, Sylvanas being the counter to the Zgara in terms of the pressure on the bottom, top and bot lane. We saw what Ninja and his team were doing. We're just completely nullifying out that pressure in the bot lane. So that was very nicely played by them. And I think it really helped their case in the game.
We'll feed that one back to the boys over at the desk. We've got Disco and Happy Rage tuned in. Are you still there, guys?
Yeah, definitely.
And man, that first game in Negative Synergy were just so dominating in it. Their rotations were on pack, the way they were putting pressure in the lanes. They really had a game plan from the word go, and they stuck to it, and they just came out on top in every way and stage of that match.
The one thing that I noticed is at least two or three times Negative Synergy would rotate to the bottom lane, where pretty much the entire team of Vice was, and they kept getting team wipes, like, at least three times, and it just kept bolstering them ahead. They go through the bottom keep, and then that's what allowed them to use the Dragonite through the bottom and finish off that game. But the rotations were pretty much on point.
Mm. Well, just everything in Negative Synergy in that game, just everything was on point. Mm. You know, it's, I mean, even the way they're putting pressure on those lanes as well, they had the Dragonite up. They left the Dragonite alone. They sent four members essentially bottom. They pushed that bottom wall in, destroyed it, destroyed the fortifications, went through, destroyed the keep. They were always, always grouped together. Where you saw with Vice, they played a bit more of a spread out game, where they had three members in top, two in the mid and bottom. Now, granted, they were trying to soak EXP. They were behind a lot of that game. So it's a good idea. Get into the lanes, soak the experience. But at those crucial moments, they weren't responding to Negative Synergy. They weren't even counter-pushing themselves. Oh, they're four of them in bottom. All right, maybe we can send two bottom and leave two or three up top. And just try to put a little bit of pressure. Maybe we can convince them to come back behind.
Well, but to be fair, every single time they tried to split-push bottom, the five-man drone came down and just wiped them out.
Every time they did overextend that little bit and get a little bit of confidence, they did get punished and got pushed back into the ground. So it was still a really good game to watch. Just so mechanically well played by Negative Synergy.
Is that the draft link that we've just received? Let's have a look. Nah.
All right, so we are waiting for the next draft link to get set up so we can go in and see what they're going to do in the next match. But so what do you think that Vice need to take away from that, guy? So Skimmy and Starvik, Vice, they just had their first game against Negative Synergy. What do you think is the big thing they need to discuss and change going into the next game?
I would probably say, just from my experience in the game, obviously they're very good players. This is only the first game, so I don't want to bad talk them or anything. They did well, you know. But one thing I did notice is, like, with the Divine Shields and stuff, with the Uther pick, I mean, Uther was such a strong pick, and I just don't really feel like he had much power that game. One thing I thought that they could possibly work on was just the way they approach fights. Every time there was a fight, it was a lot of movement, taking a lot of damage with nothing really happening for them on their side, you know. Whereas, obviously, Robert Dober and his team, a lot of CC coming out. Their team comp just allows for damage to be consistent. It's always coming out. Whereas, if you're on Vice's team, you know, you actually have to be on them, doing the damage all the time. You know, it's
a lot more bursty Ninja Sight, I believe. So, to take away from that, I don't know. I really feel like they seemed a bit nervous is what I would take away from that. I really think they will do a lot better this game.
Well, we did see that ETC was banned out by negative synergy against Vice, and that might have been a key component. They were looking for that lockdown. So that's what they were missing. They didn't really have that one hero that could go in and lock down two or three heroes and get those, you know, living bombs coming out from Kel'Thas, really spreading the damage. So maybe it's just they didn't quite adapt to their team composition. They didn't really plan too much what happens if ETC is removed from our lineup. If that was the plan at all, maybe.
Well, to chip in for my final thoughts on that game would be, we did mention Zagara was a staple as an early game powerhouse, so we saw how much work it did. And if you compare in the early game where they sent three members from Vice up to try and push Zagara back, when we saw the response from Negative Synergy, they actually got a keep, a fort and two towers out of it whilst they rotated up. All they did is basically push the wave in to Ninja. So they get that snowball advantage that allowed them to really keep pushing on. And once you get that XP lead, you get a talent advantage, you get a good team fight, it can really start to snowball from there.
And I mean, Urtha and the Vices team, essentially, they have the potential to be so much stronger in the later game, and we just didn't see the later game out of them. So effectively, you know, Ninja and his team, they were moving towards the late game and leaving them in the dust, which was just allowed them, like you were saying, the snowball factor, and just allowed them to be that much easier.
Yeah, another thing that I noticed was the target priority on Vice. They seem to be targeting Johanna a lot. Yes, she's the furthest target to them, so, you know, it is the easy option to hit, but they really needed to be focusing down that Valor. That Valor got off so many strafes, pretty much full durations on multiple people. Like, you need the Sonya to be leaping on her, you need, the Uther to be ready to stun her, all that sort of stuff. So the focusing on the specific characters and trying to reevaluate which ones they need to hit more.
So, as an interesting question, we talked a lot about Vice, what we hopefully we're going to see out of them in the next game. Here's a little bit of turn. What do you think that Negative Synergy has to improve on for their next match? Like, what did they really do? They did get... Jaina got caught a couple of times in that game. Only a couple of kills went to Vice's way, but Jaina was getting caught out. Do you think there's anything on there, or do you think there was a bait tactic on Negative Synergy?
It's hard to say, because they won that game quite easily, you know.
Fairly convincingly.
It's quite hard to say what they need to improve on, because we haven't seen anyone yet, obviously, with the first game, anyone really put them in their place. So, I mean, I'm going to put a rain check on that question.
Let's pull that away for later.
Very good one.
Not too easy. So we are, like I said, guys, we are still just waiting for the draft link into the next match. It's coming to you very, very shortly.
Do you just want to throw Robidoba a message and see if they're actually drafting or not? Oh.
So we do have a link actually getting thrown to us now.
Oh, Robidoba. Actually not even picking up the level 16 talent. Great plays by him. I am being sent a link for a draft now. I'll page it through to you guys.
All right.
That's the one I have on my screen.
Sky Temple.
And the draft has actually already begun. Negative Synergy with the first ban, first pick once again. Sky Temple, as Starving mentioned there, is the battleground of choosing Zagara, instantly being taken out. We mentioned it before in Dragonshire. Yeah. You can either pick it or you can deny it. They have chosen to do it in this case. Draft actually has been flipped around. Taran now being banned out by Vice. And Negative Synergy, lots of options to start this draft off with. Mm. You've got to be, I say, drafting is an interesting kind of... phase, if you will. You've got to sort of have a plan pre-programmed before, because you can sort of choke and draft really yourself into things you don't actually want.
Exactly.
Especially when you've got a time pool counting you down, you're looking at that and you sort of get the stress levels going up and you're kind of like, oh, not too sure we want to choose there.
Oh, but a very nice first pick there by Negative Synergy. A hero with a lot of mobility and a hero of the storm, Felstead. So I always love seeing Felstead. We've been seeing people take up Mighty Gust a lot. And that's something that wasn't really used for a long while. You know, people tended to go for the.
What do you guys think of the latest change, the Hinterland Blast? It's doing a lot more damage now, but it's got a longer duration. Do you think that that's going to up its priority being taken over Mighty Gust, or do you think it really depends on the team composition?
It really depends on the team comp, because we see a lot of Mighty Gust for combinations where you can blow back the targets you don't want and just sort of blow up somebody. We did see, obviously, Mighty Gust. used quite religiously recently, but the Hinterland Blast was a big one back in the day, and I say they still haven't locked in Fausted. They do now, 5 seconds of their time pool's only remaining, so they were really thinking about that pick for sure. Mm. They do lock it in now, but I say Hinterland Blast would be a lovely one to see, but it really is conditional on what kind of comp they're choosing and what kind of comp Vice decide to go. If they do take Uther, it negates a lot of that burst potential.
And even we've seen like Zero, I'm not sure if you just mentioned that before, but the Zero Tool with the Fausted, you can chuck a VP down a Mighty Gust the rest of the way, drop the VP, and you've got yourself a target to kill, don't you? So we actually see the same as before, Uther and Kalthas being the first picks for Vice, second time around. This is a very standard thing to see in ANZ, not ANZ, HOTS anyway, in general, but HOTS in general. Uther, it's just, you can't go wrong with him, can you? If he's not banned, why not pick him? Such a strong support, really fits into any really team composition that you have. Obviously, there are some heroes that are better suited, but he's just got such a great spell set, so he's always such a strong pick.
You can't let him get through the draft for free, and we do say, Jayne are now picked up again. Same sort of drafts coming out, minus a few changes here and there, but negative synergy, they do lock in their cow as well. Big ETC, they're not too phased that they have Uther on Vice, and Disco, what are your thoughts on the draft so far?
Yeah, I was looking at Vice thinking, okay, Vice are going for the ETT strategy again, trying to lock him in. And negative synergy, I thought, oh, they'll probably follow up with a ban. But not this time. They've actually decided to take the ETC instead. I mean, combine that with Hinterland Blast, combine that with Jayne, if she says takes Ring of Frost. I mean, that is, whoever gets caught can just get annihilated. Of course, they've got the Uther with the stun. Vice have Uther. They have Kel'Thas with the Gravity Lapse. So there's a bit of options there to cancel out that mosh pit. But, I mean, if they're both captured, they can't do anything against it.
Yeah, so, I'm a huge fan of ETC, though. Yeah. Just loves in the mosh pits, eh? Just jumps in, slides in, and just shreds that guitar.
Plays a wee bit of Guitar Hero on his Xbox makes things happen.
It's a big play heroic. You know, it's just, it's always massive when it goes down. Three-man mosh pit, four-man mosh pit, five-man mosh pit. Like, you just
mosh pit.
Yeah, I've seen so many games where, like, you're behind, and then your ETC just pulls off a massive mosh pit in Hero League, and you're just like, yes, we can come back.
Yeah. We won. Thank you.
It turns the game. You're five levels down. You manage to kill them somehow, and you just rush core.
All that experience is delicious.
So, Vice, they do actually ban Sonya. They're not keen to pick it up this time. They possibly not too happy with how it panned out yesterday, or last game, not yesterday, but it seems like yesterday already, eh? Joanna is the one that they're hovering over so far. I'm not too sure if the time pool's glitched out. I'm seeing 00 on my side, but whether or not that can be confirmed on your end, Happy Rage, is Joanna being locked in as a ban?
Just wait and see.
What do you call it? Disconcur, just like, I took down the screen so I can't see it anymore.
Just send a little message just asking them, hey guys, is draft working?
00, great Heroes Draft website. Thank you, Blizzard, for providing an in-game one. We do love you, Blizzard. Thanks for the opportunity to cast this tournament here, but we'll wait for this to go in. There we go. Joanna has been banned.
Thrall
and Reynolds. As quick and quick as that, they're not hanging around with this one. Thrall and Reynolds, two big powerhouses, so much damage that can really come out and disintegrate somebody like Jayne or Fausted.
Wonderful. See this earthquake ground from Thrall. I love that spell, just splitting the team and really creating havoc. Could be quite nice.
And you could easily take it as well, because Vice already have a lot of damage from Reynolds and Kel'Thas. So you could take, you know, Thrall, just his, you know, Chain Lightning, and then just use his Earthquake. You don't need the little bit of extra damage from Sundering. So it's quite possible that we are going to see Earthquake come out of Thrall.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and imagine if we saw a Malfurion ultimate go off, and then just the split, he gets pushed away from his team, and now he's just suddenly healing no one but himself. That'd be hilarious. but yeah, I love Thrall. He's a very, very nice character. And are we going to see a Diablo? Is he going to just lock him in?
Bring in the devils.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
He does commit for the Lord of Terror. He's going to wreak havoc on this game. Lord of Terror, beam of light as he breathes across the entire map and the battlefield itself. And Malfurion and Valor, once again, they're very comfortable in these picks. Rob playing a wonderful Valor there. Whether or not he's going to be the one of choosing in this game as well. But the drafts have been locked in. We'll wait for this lobby to jump in. And once again, thoughts on this draft. I'll pass over to you, Happy.
My thoughts, up front, I like Vice's team comp more.
Yeah.
However, I feel like the stability of negative synergy is a little bit more higher and will prevail. Mm. But if they can manage to burst somebody down, Reyna gets a lot of auto attacks out. They might be able to take away team fights. I don't think Malfurion can really keep up with the amount of damage that could come out. It's just whether they'll get that opportunity to do so.
I really like Diablo in the early game as well. His CC is just so strong in the early game. You know, you get that stun off, you pull them over the shoulder. You don't have much health at the start. You don't have much utility with your team, so you can get picked off very easily. So hopefully what we see from Vice is that Diablo going in and really utilizing the early game advantage that Diablo does have and can just rip onto quite literally and figuratively, as Diablo does so well. I'm a very big fan of Diablo, especially because you didn't really see him around too much. Oh, like in the alpha, you saw him, people playing him quite a bit. Fell off for a long time, and everyone just thought he was really bad. But I think it's just because he's not the coolest looking character. I really like the skinny looking Diablo.
He's quite a high skilled Diablo. Like, he's a high skilled hero, I find Diablo. It's he's overpowers. You can save the enemy team if you misplay those. Throw them into spots that don't help you. Your charge pushes them back again. You can push the enemy team out of the danger zone. So he's quite sort of high skill cap in that regard. Lightning breath, you pop it. People can just walk around you, get behind you. Comes a little bit useless. Even his Apocalypse, same sort of deal. So he's very high skill cap hero. Very dependent on the team composition. And looking at Vice's competition, I think it worked fairly well because he can overpower. Then we have Kel'Thas or even Uther follow up with stuns to lock him in place. So I think it's a very good draft that Vice had picked up. However, look at negative synergy. I mean, they've got that ETC, and I've been thinking about it. I mean, maybe we are going to see Thrall take Sundering just as another method to cancel out that mosh pit. So I'm just so excited. I mean, both teams have drafted great compositions. And I'm just going to, I can't wait to see how they interact. And like, I mean, talents are really going to play just not an extraordinary role in this game, what each takes to try and counter out each other, especially when it gets to those level 10s. Hopefully we don't see just standard picks here. We see some real hard thought gone into Mighty Gush taken to prevent the sort of burst nature coming out from Vice when Diablo runs in, or maybe not. You know, it's really interesting. Are we going to see team dynamic?
Well, that's it. I mean, there's so many different ways you can go with these ultimates. I mean, you have the potential to try and stack CC.
Apo could be really good against the ETC as well. The Diablo could effectively just wait for the power slide to come out. And then, effectively, you can tell when the ETC ultimate's coming, right? It's pretty obvious. You just wait, hit the ultimate, and then, sure enough, APOC, thank you for that. And it's just a bit sad. So, I mean, I think we're going to pass this one off to Happy Raging Disco. Is it? What's going on?
We are going to actually finish this series before we pass it back to them. Yeah. So we're going to run this one straight through to the end.
Awesome. That's what I like. So go and listen and have some fun, lads.
Let us sing you a lullaby as we do load up Sky Temple.
Sing me a song.
Second game of the series. It is a best of three in the winner's bracket. Loser does drop down to the loser's bracket. They're not completely out. They can work their way back through to the final. So it's not curtains if you are knocked out first round. And we'll kick things off again. We'll run through the two team comps. Who is playing who? Once again, on the red side there, we do have ETC being played by Robodoba. Ninja is on Falsted. Session is playing Butler this time. Desperts is on Malfurion. And Benjamin94 is playing Jaina once again.
And on Vice, we have Jedi Dude we saw before playing Diablo. Altalize playing Thrall. Judvoria playing Raynor, Shi playing Kel'Thas, and Yablet playing Uther again. I believe he's playing Uther last game, so let's see if they can do it this time. 1-0 to NS on negative synergy. Synergy, can't even talk today. I'm a shoutcaster, but I'm supposed to be. And let's see if Vice can bring it back.
Well, they have learnt from their decisions last time. Vice now stacked as a five-man unit. We tend to see this quite a lot in Hero League games, and it is the bane of our existence if we fight for these watchtowers. Rob does actually get it, but they are a four-man unit, except for Raynor hanging back so he doesn't get picked off. They do chuck him the spy! The spy going straight on towards Kel'Thas. He's getting dropped so low, he drops instantly. They're turning their attention now to Thrall. Benjamin drops in the entire skirmish as well. Thrall coming down now. They're focusing onto Diablo. Diablo's super low. He drops as well, and that's a 3-for-1 exchange. They're not going to be too upset with losing Ben there. And you can always see a slight XP advantage. Lovely power slide.
I mean, that was very smart by the Falstead. They did know that they were somewhere around the mid lane. They have been kind of converging around the mid lane in the last game as well. So that was just very, very nice. Ninja chucking out that wee Stormbolt and managed to pick up their kill, well, the kills for the team there by spotting them effectively. And that was just a bit scary there for our team Vice. But they hopefully should be able to hold back now. They should be able to sort this out. There is a bit of pushing in the top lane and a big push from our team.
So here we see in the mid lane now, same as before, four-man units stacked up towards trying to get this early tower and try and cement a small little XP advantage early on into this game. It really can snowball if you don't actually respond to it. KT doing a lot of work on that tower as well, dropping it to half. Does thankfully back away just in time for these temples. You don't want to be dying before a big objective. You need all your members as these first two temples spawn.
Oh, Shishi having a bit of an engage and going very low. Nice gravity lapse to keep him alive. Is he going to survive this though? Oh, very close multi-shot, just missing out on a kill there.
And we do see Vice actually going for their respective capture point, and Ninja just being a bit cheeky, hovering around, trying to see if there's anything he can do about that. Looks like no, he's actually opting to just chill out. Session and the rest coming down, and are they going to rendezvous with Ninja, and are they going to make a fight out of this? Ultralize taking a bit of damage, being forced off the point there. Robodoba sitting up top by himself, so their tank is out. Nice route coming out, and Vala is going to go down. Very nice pick by Jedi Dude, and Yablet there, the power. Oh, Diablo, that we're talking about before. Diablo going down so, so low, though. Shishi and his team need to get out of there. They've done what they need to do. Heals are on CD, and all of them are pretty much effectively just, they aren't ready for this combat, so they need to get out. They've done what they can, and the XP lead isn't too big. They don't want to give them much more here.
So ETC getting a full capture on the top there. Reynold the whole time was pushing out bots, so Negative Synergy responded by going and trying to contest this mid lane. They did get a kill and they did get the last remaining shots, but they did lose Vala as a result. Not to worry though, they are a half level lead ahead in this game, and they do have the Faustor there for the global presence, so maybe that was the decision by Reynor there to try and counteract that as they do go for an early easy camp.
Yeah, presence indeed. The presence is overwhelming here. anyway, moving on, we are seeing Dasbird, Session, and Benjamin move up through the mid lane. That mid tower looking pretty unhealthy there, so they're probably pretty keen to get that soon. And the XP lead's going very minimal. Here comes Robodoba coming in with a stun. A lot of damage coming out. Jedi Dude getting pushed back and throw. Actually, well, the one getting focused fire down there. Not much they can do. And how much burst do they have there? Very, very nice. And Benjamin by himself. I mean, we're no stranger to Jaina, are we? So much damage just like that comes out. And the combo comes out. You get crit. You're pretty much dead. Let's be honest.
You die a very cold death. And she is a burst mage if ever. Two hotly contested picks, both KT and Jaina. You don't want to let those go through draft uncontested, so you are, in some cases, forced to pick them up. And, well, Diablo forced to try and actually back away from this one. He is a tank, but he's been tanking way too much here as they try and pick up the knights. And there's interesting strategies you can do with this one. You can time it just in terms of the next shrine that will be coming in that bottom lane, and that can do a lot of work on its own.
Looks like, as well, with Valor actually opting to go for the multi-shot build there, might be just to slow down the mobility of the red team. I would really think so. They've got quite a lot of melee composition on their end. So here comes Robodoba again, though, actually going in for a cheeky stun, but they're not going to engage. I think just trying to relieve the pressure there. The next temple is activating in 10 seconds. Going to be in the bot lane. So are we going to see Robodoba run down a bit quicker than Ninja? Because he can fly down, of course. But, of course, the pressure is quite real up here. Maybe they want to keep him up there for as long as they can.
I feel as what they're going to do is try and push out this night camp, keep Ninja up here for as absolute long as possible, because he can soak, and as you mentioned, he can fly down in his own free will, so it's like, Kelfast, if you're stuck up here, then I'm doing a job for my team. Three members are now responding down, ETC's coming for a drive-by, he does decide to back out from that one, and shots fired already, Daspy being the target of choosing, he's already on towards that temple doing shots for the team. And Fausted still sitting pretty in that top lane. Redside now pushing in as a five-man unit. They're saying, we have the numbers advantage. We might be a whole level down.
Here comes Fausted. Here he comes. They are probably opting to get into this fight here. Jedi Dude taking the front line. Shishi in a bit of a weird situation there. Needs to kind of back out. Roots coming out onto Jedi Dude. Diablo in a bit of a situation. Yablet in a three stun coming out. Nice Blizzard coming out from Jaina getting the first pick. Yablet's going to go down as well. That is the second pick. He, of course, is going to be healing and through his death, though. And Thrall, you are, I'm so sorry, sir, you are going to be taken out as well. Very unfortunate there, but this just shows the power, and even Happy Rage was talking about this before, the power and the utility on the blue team side. Negative Synergy, they don't have negative synergy, they have quite positive synergy, and it's working out very positive for
it
them.
It is a play on words, definitely they have a lot of synergy to pull off these sort of plays right now. Two level advantage, they do have the ultimates as well. They have opted for the Mighty Gust. We were contesting that one before. It is a pretty standard pick, and especially with the amount of dive that Vice have at their disposal, it's not a bad ultimate to choose there.
Despert's being a bit risky there, jumping in, trying to do a bit of damage, and it looks like Ultralize might actually get taken out here. Blizzard coming out, he's going so low. Indeed he does. So a bit scary there. Ninja is a bit of a trouble, but no, maybe he's just baiting them. Yablet now by himself as well. Shishi going down very low. They do have their ultimates up. Do they choose to fight this? Here comes a big team fight. Tranquility being popped. Shishi going very low. Jeddo Dude also in a bit of a predicament as well. Are they going to get out of there? Yes, they are. They didn't want to go under that tower. Fair enough, but man, they are getting picks left, right, center, northeast, northwest, southeast, and southwest.
They're like a compass, they're going absolutely ham. Diablo jumps in there, probably not the play you want to do, mate. You tried to flip, but now you're just going to flip yourself back to the graveyard. He does get blown away there. Lovely little particle graphics as the ragdoll effect does go in full effect. And well, this is the time when you can really try and force your advantage. They have the ETC, they have so much commanding presence to just jump in and force an engagement. They could even look to go for the boss right now. They have four members in the top lane, all because of Ninja's presence there. And, they decided to just go for the easy, get a bit of pressure in the bot lane. And they still aren't too happy to go for the boss. Boss, mind you, it is a bit of a throw pit at the best of times.
Yeah.
There's been lots of times where people have a big lead and they throw it in an instance.
And this is one of those leads that isn't that large at the moment. But, oh, Robin Turba running into Jeddi Dude. Altalize actually missing that immobilize there. So, very, very unfortunate. Yablet now getting punched out by a big cow. There's a cow in the long grass. Get him out of there, they're saying. They're running after. But they still have a bit of a level disadvantage here. Level 13 is about to be picked up by Robidoba and his team, or Ninja's team, respectively. But another shrine, temple rather, is about to activate in the bottom lane. And we do actually see that Felstead's in a good position to kind of take that one in the mid if he chooses to. But I do think they're going to force a fight. Try and get that 13 and force the fight. Big stuns coming out. Are we going to see the mosh pit already? Yes, we are. Not quite. He does get stunned out of the Altalize, taking a lot of damage. It does look like ETC might drop here, but that is okay. Not too important. Mighty Gust into ETC. Is he going to get the mosh pit? Are we going to see it? No, unfortunately not. And does not need it anyway. Two picks already for them. Ninja taking out Altalize. Shishi is certainly going to go down too. And ETC running around that whole time, so cheeky, and just very well played by Robidoba there, soaking a lot of damage.
Clean ace, mosh pit wasn't even used, Apoc didn't even get a chance to even be popped, Diablo got absolutely burst, minced meat, he wasn't even seen as a tank, they just looked at him as a squishy assassin. Straight away, the call is, go to boss, we can take that, they had to respond to it, we can pick up two shrines for free, and that's what they're doing. No, they're not finished there, they're going straight for the easiest as well, so much denial, and this is something that lots of confident teams would do. Yeah. They have an advantage, they will press it, they will take as much as possible away from you. And Marafiria now going to take the shrine in the bottom lane whilst the rest of the team are going to go for the mid.
I mean, this is a very tricky situation for Team Vice. They've got a boss in the bottom lane, they've also got an easy camp in the bottom lane. There's two temples up. Do you sacrifice the temples? You're going to get damaged anyway.
Do you have
to. With the boss? You have to sacrifice the temples, that's the only way. But this is smart by Team Negative Synergy. The smart thing to do here is you have the control. You can do whatever you want here. So they're opting to do as much damage to the structures as they can while they are dealing with that boss. And they know that they can just simply walk away. Felstead doing his best he can to take that shrine down so they only have to fight for the last remaining shrine, or temple rather, keep saying shrines. But he's going to be taking down that one shrine, leaving one left, and then they can easily just go down or even opt to get some hard camps.
And I love this by Negative Synergy, that he's decided, all right, we have the boss in the bottom lane pushing, rather than going for the shrines whilst they're uncontested, the temples, you got me saying it now as well, they actually went for the mid lane and pushed in two towers for absolute free. Loved it. Absolutely loved it. It was great by them, and they do now go to pick it up now. 15-12, and they're starting to have a big commanding lead, just like last game.
Yeah, just like last game indeed, but I know this map, you know, you do have a bit of time to react. It's just if they can catch up. If they can get the XP they need, they can't get wiped here. They need to have a very good fight. But, I mean, Ninja already coming in. Are we going to see a Mighty Gust? This could be very important. Shishi already getting taken out. And, oh, my Lord, Apoc actually missing the bulk of that. Jaynab already popping your ice bot. Big ETC ultimate dropping down there. And are we going... Oh, nice Divine Shield keeping Raider alive just for that fraction a bit more. But Jeddi Dude cannot keep him alive any more than that. There is just no damage there. Not enough. And with a four-level advantage, my friends and family, they are going down this fight.
Wow, commanding team fight once again. It's been happening all day, every day. Only one member dropping again, and it seems to be the man of the hour. It's Benjamin94 say in chat right now, he is a feeder. Donate to UNICEF because he needs some food.
He may as well be starving.
Great jokes on the board here. Ninja, he can join the rest of his team in a second with that flight, and he's just picking up a free shrine. He's absolutely happy with that one.
Well, yeah, I mean, he has the full right to. He has a free Boeing 747 at his disposal. Free flights to Auckland for Ninja there. He can go straight up north, straight down, back down, south, Queenstown, wherever you want to go. Maybe even Australia. So he's flying all over the place. Hardcamp's being picked up by here. Vice, 4-level advantage here. I mean, I really hate to say it, but it is turning out a lot like last game. I want nothing more than Vice to come back on a really positive note on a big team fight. They certainly have the capability for it, but I mean, Team Negative Synergy are just displaying perfect synergy. They're doing very well, and all the plays, they are making the plays, and there is very responsive play style by Vice in this situation.
So during the interval here, we did see them both pick up the Merc Camps in that top-hand side. An interesting talent of choosing is the Tenacious Roots coming out of Malfurion there. He's opting for the larger Entangling Root, and it lasts a wee bit longer too, so they're looking to try and lock up targets for as long as possible. Double Giant Killer coming out from both Thrall and Raynor there. And Ninja flying in extremely aggressive there. He's coming in as a scouting ward, if you will, to see if they're going to go for the easy. They're playing so very patiently. They don't know that they're there. They do now. Robidob is coming in. He's looking for the slide. They're going straight to Diablo. Diablo getting smashed straight away. The Sundering, the Hyperion, both being popped. Nothing is going to happen there, and they pick up the easy camp for complete free once again. Look at this commanding lead. Sashin coming on the side, doing a bit of a drive-by. Is the drive-by going to take place? He does hold on the Glock 94, Benjamin 94. He's holding on to the strafe for just a little wee bit longer. The fault is already gone down. The keep, actually, in the mid lane has gone down. They're looking to go in for the bottom shrine now, the bottom keep. What's going on with these words? Take us away there, mate.
Yeah, it does look like this is trying to be their final push here. Robidob is certainly in a positive situation. All ultimates are up for Negative Synergy, allowing them to get some nice synergy plays off of their ultimate. So I'm sure they're feeling very confident. Best thing for them to do, of course, run up to top and get those temples, or should I say shrines. No, I shouldn't, shrines, because indeed, that's the wrong name. They are going to be pushing this top lane. Like I said before, they can do anything they please at this point. They do have the leveled advantage, and Jedi Dude here and his team trying to make something of nothing here. Robidob going down, he's getting a bit of damage dealt to him, but the zoning just accumulated from that entangling roots. Here comes Ninja Mighty Ghost!
Mighty Ghost, it goes off completely huge. There's the Apoc. The Mosh Pit was trying to go out, but it doesn't actually get off. Divine Shield going into KT, ETC drops straight away. Oh, look at Despy. He has got the Tranquility going on. It will persist through the ice block. One for one, both tanks dropping from that engage, and that may be the calling to back away, as the two temples have been around for a wee bit of time there. They do decide to back away. Two keeps have gone now. These shots are going to be banging on towards that last one, and once that's done, the next temple is going to be on towards that core. You do get put on a bit of a timer here, but look at this. Vice is saying we may be one member down, but you are too.
Yeah. Oh, they actually opting to go for another mini fight here. Benjamin getting dropped down a little bit. Mighty Gust pushing them away. The utility of the Mighty Gust. So large. They have Ping Sash in there. They do know he's there. Shishi getting a bit dropped. Very scary for him. Nice kiting there. Mobilize isn't hitting. Yablin a bit out of range for the stun. Is he going to get away? Nice shielding there on the Sash. Can he get away? He's running. Nice ultimate being popped. A lot of damage coming up. Please stay alive, Sash. Please, he's running. Mobilize misses.
Sashin, so huge. He lives on a sliver of HP, only 70 HP.
He aggroes
the boss. He's got balls of a bloody ball. Ooh. Don't know what he's doing, but he aggroes the boss. ETC. Damn. That is absolutely chaotic plays going on right here. The temple in the entire engagement does go off in the mid lane there. And Vice now gathering themselves together as a five-man squad. Thrall did die on... We are living in third world country, and we may...
Alright, we've had a bit of a problem here. ETC's gone, got the mosh pit. It's three members on Vice have been caught now. Divine Shield has gone out, keep Raynor alive. However, Dialer will fall, and Raynor will fall behind this. The level difference was just too huge for either team for Vice to really do anything in that fight.
Yeah, I think Sashin's play from that last... Yeah, that survival run that he did through the bottom just killed Skimmy and Starving's internet. So we're just going to have to quickly take over. was not ready for this.
It was too much packets of excitement. And we see here, the blue team, see Native Sinew, they are just combanding the rest of this game, and this will be their victory rush to the core. It's not even a rush, everyone's dead on the enemy team. Yeah. What are they going to do? And there we have it. First game, Negative Synergy versus Vice 2-0 going the way of Negative Synergy.
Sorry about that, lads.
Are we back in there, boys? Yeah. I don't know what happened there. Maybe a sheep ate the cables, but instead shit drop on us.
That's right. Can
you go put the sheep... yeah, we've got a couple.
Yeah, I'll chuck it back in the paddock, mate. She'll go back away. Give us some hay.
Well, yeah, take the sheep outside. Thanks.
Yeah, cheers, mate. All right, let's load this game back up.
Yeah, sorry about that, lads. Not sure what happened there.
No, that's all right.
It wouldn't be ANZ without a couple crashes.
Without some sheep.
Yeah, fantastic.
When you get a chance, guys, you need to turn your video back on.
A video.
Ooh. Let's have a look at our lovely little face. Check us out. We'll swag that today in some dress shirts. Clean shaven, baby face. Ooh. To love it.
Baby face. Speak for yourself.
Maybe a Q10, mate. Anti-aging. Let's go.
You have a baby face, but I have a man's face. Says Starving. With that lovely mustache.
Game sound here, sorry. There we go.
Not too easy.
Nah, it's all good.
So you guys missed out on exciting. There was a last moment where Vice tried to push something, but we just saw Negative Synergy just lay another trap, bait them in again, and ETC went in and got a three-man mosh pit, and that just spelled disaster for Vice, and that was the end of the game.
Well, wasn't good for me.
That chase on Vala. That was awesome.
Yeah. Oh, that
highlight clip right there. He was like, please, love.
But the Spirit Wolf dodged the Spirit Wolf, got the Ranger out of the range of gravity laps, out of the Uther's stun. Awesome. I mean, and Thrall almost had a lightning bolt came out on 80 HP. And then to aggro the boss as well on the way past.
Yeah, that's crazy. Oh my god, I was like, what are you doing? And then we DC'd. It must have been, we were so excited when we got DC'd.
So excited that the game just blew up.
Your shrieks of excitement was just too much for your ISP to handle. Too many packets. Oh god, that was a good game. I enjoyed that game. Yeah. But get back a bit more serious then. So we saw a slightly different game out of Negative Synergy that time. Yeah. In game one, we saw them rotating really well into the different lanes. And they were still doing that. They were still there. But they played much more of a baiting game this time. They actually trapped Vice so many times. They fell for it. They revealed their trap card and bam, Vice were just taken out. And so it's interesting to see that Negative Synergy does have different play styles. Catering to, I guess, the different maps. Because we're on Sky Temple, it's much larger. I don't know, what's your take on that, Happy Rage?
The Dragon Shire game was a lot more of rotating down and having team fights, where this one was have Ninja out in the front. He can easily escape with the barrel roll or fly if he needs to. And he's just poking them, making them want to go out there and kill him. Meanwhile, Robodoba's sitting behind him, Benjamin's inside the bush, and they just come out with the stun, Jaina combo, and they're gone.
Yep. Yeah, done now. And we saw that again and again and again in the game.
Over and over.
Yep.
What I thought was quite interesting was how the ETC was playing. On Negative Synergy, I think what he knew in that team fight was he was going to have a really, really hard time getting those ultimates
off.
What we saw was ETC going in, getting stunned again, and to be honest, it would have been perfect if he had popped his ultimate.
Yep.
But half the time he wasn't even popping it. They'd be wasting so much CC and so much damage on the ETC. And for nothing, for what, you know? It was just, he was getting these massive stuns off. I mean, the damage, essentially, or the CC had already been done on ETC's end. Stunning him doesn't really help him too much, you know? So
it was the fear of the mosh pit, wasn't it? He went in there and he made Vice scared of it. I mean, what did Vice take? They took Sundering to help cancel the mosh pit. They took Apocalypse to help cancel the mosh pit. I mean, they took so much to respond to it. They were so scared of it that they almost got blindsided by it. And you saw how they acted in those fights. So much focus on ETC, but he's a tank. He's going to absorb it all.
To be fair, they did too have two giant killers, which could have helped a lot. But we saw... I really feel like Diablo, it may not have been the best pick. The Apoc, you know, I mean, generally, I think... Negative Synergy, they've just been playing really well, but you know, we didn't really see too much synergy coming out of Vice, unfortunately, you know. And with Diablo, he would be in the front line. He's not the tankiest of tanks later game as well, especially if you're in a level disadvantage. He was getting melted. It was ridiculous. And we saw the utility of Vala in that last fight when she was getting chased by Thrall. She slowed and pulled away. Four members of the team managed to get a pick and managed to live. So, I mean, yeah, when I saw the multi-shot build on Vala, everything just went really nicely for negative synergy. Synergy is real, like I said before.
Zoning out Falstad, could be a little bit of trouble here. Hurdles comes back in, but he will be the first to fall in that fight. Is next here, a lot of damage going on. However, Dark Horse could be in a bit of a detrimental situation here. Clapton trying to get away, and he will.